A dynamic public servant is how he is described today. This man has a fascinating story. Many years ago, and for those of you who are my age or close to my age, you'll remember that there was a newspaper in town that you can't start your day without picking a copy of it. He's right here with us. He was a photographer. He was covering everything that happened in town. Today, he's doing incredible things in the United States of America. We're going to talk to him right now. Pius Ali. Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good.
How are you? It's good to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Look, me, I'm blown away. The transition from what you used to do to where you find yourself now, in between there are many stories, I'm sure. Now, take us back to when? The 90s?
Yeah.
80s, 90s? How did you start? How did you get into PMP in the first place? How did you get to pick up the first camera and start shooting? And why?
Right. So, thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome.
I went to West Africa Secondary School.
Okay.
And
Adenta.
Yeah, we were the first class.
Okay.
The first class that graduated at Adenta in 2000.
Okay.
In 1989.
Okay.
89.
Yeah.
Okay.
When I was in my second year at West Africa Secondary School, I signed up for an art class. But for God's sake, I don't know how to draw. I can imagine a scene in my head, but the challenge is I cannot transfer this onto a paper. And then just as it happened, someone gave me a gift of a camera.
Okay.
And I started taking pictures around Accra.
Mm.
So I will create a scene in my mind, and then I will go out there and look for that scene.
Okay.
Imagine it, and it's not perfect like the scenery that I thought, but it is.
I got close something. To it, yeah.
And I will bring. I will save money. I started a photo club at West Africa Secondary School with my friends, and it's a boys' school at Accra Newtown.
Mm.
So there wasn't. It wasn't that traction. But I do save money, and then I will go and print my pictures.
Mm.
And then one day I was printing the pictures, and I met someone at a photo print, and he said, "Did you take these pictures?" I said, "Yes." And that person introduced me to another person. I covered my first fashion photographs, I think after I've graduated from West Africa.
Okay.
It was organized by a group of young people at either GIS, it's a fundraising event for a group of students at GIS.
Okay.
And then we took the pictures. And then I got into the fashion industry. Young people doing fashion shows and performances. Then when you see artists like Reggie and others who rap, the mainstream photographers didn't wanna, they see it as a foreign.
Yes.
So I'm always, almost always around. So I became that photographer who is almost always around things that are in town that is hip, right? Then one day, I was coming from where Joy FM is right now.
Okay.
There is a, how do we call it? There's a photo studio.
Mm.
I was on my way. I was walking towards that intersection to take a car back to Accra. And then there was a newly constructed building that collapsed. And the photographer in me, was there, it was the right time at the right place, I took pictures.
Yeah.
And PMP was just about to start printing. And the person who was the editor who was going to start it was looking for someone to take the pictures. And he found someone. But then someone else who knew me saw me taking the pictures. And they said, well, you might want to contact this guy. I have his number. And then he reached out to me. And when I gave him my pictures, he looked at mine. And the one that was taken by the photographer that he commissioned, mine was far better.
Mm-hmm.
So they published mine. But prior to that, I have done a little bit of work for other people.
Okay.
So when PMP published that, and then they asked me, do you want to work with us? Because we don't have a photographer. So started publishing my PMP. It was much more bigger platform than what I had as an individual.
Okay.
And that led to other newspapers and magazines And then when the radio stations got started, I became the one that everyone invites to come and take pictures for them.
Amazing.
Wait, so which year did you leave Ghana?
I left Ghana in 2000.
Right, so when you were leaving, you were a photographer.
Right.
What made you decide to live? And when you were going, what was the focus? What do you think you were going to meet? Or what were you looking forward, you know, to achieve in the U.S.?
Well, every year in September.
But before that, we have cocktail. We have
something
special for you. You love it.
I will let you know once I get there when I need to drink something.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
You don't want me to fall asleep here?
No.
When I was leaving Ghana, right, I left Ghana in September, and every September there's something that I post on my social media.
Okay.
I say that exactly X number of years ago, I made a decision to leave Ghana, where I grew up, and press the reset button of my life. And since then, my journey has been evolving. What I mean by that is that when I was leaving Ghana, to be honest with you, I don't have no idea what I was getting into. Mm. I know that I'm leaving everything that I've ever known behind, and I was going into a different world with a clean slate of knowing, didn't know what is up there. One thing that I knew then was that I'm going to work hard, buy a lot of photo equipment, and bring it back to start a photo studio
business,
or something
yeah.
bigger than what I was doing.
Wow.
That was what I had at the back of my mind when I went to the U.S.
Interesting.
But life has its own way of directing our journey.
Yeah.
So I got to U.S., one thing led to the other. Living in New York for 2 years. After that, I moved to the state that I am now, the city that I live in now.
Mm. Now, so you get to the U.S. It was your first time going there?
That was my first time of going there.
So you are coming from Ghana, playing around Kukumlimli, you know, taking photos for PMP, which even came by accidentally, you know, and then you find yourself in the land where dreams materialize. When you went there, when you got there, how were you able to settle in? You know, how did you start, you know, being so influential?
Well, I will tell you the first few days when I got to New York, there's a Photoshop that I knew from when I was here. Okay. Because I didn't have a job, I don't have anywhere to go. I live with cousins, and they fed me. So I always go to that. Every day I was spending the whole day in the Photoshop, working around, looking at the cameras that they have, and pinpointing one or two, and said, I'm definitely going to buy this and bring it back to Ghana. Like I said, life have a way of shaping and creating the journeys for us. I never get to do that. However, like many immigrants, I did a couple of menial jobs.
Like what?
I sold clothes in a shop run by an Egyptian. I sold hair in a shop that is run by a Ghanaian family friends.
Okay.
Eventually, I had dreadlocks. If you look at my pictures,
interesting.
Yeah,
you used to have dreadlocks.
Wow. I used to have dreadlocks.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then 2 years later, I moved to Maine. Where I live now. And when I got to Maine, did work in restaurants because I have to acclimatize myself, I have to understand the community that I live in. And then I got a job working with young people.
Yeah.
It's an after school program.
It's
based in the neighborhood where these young people, they will come back from school and they will come there. Myself and my colleagues that work there will help them do their homeworks. And when I started working there, I was made a coordinator for that particular neighborhood. What I did was, instead of just doing homeworks, I moved the project one step up by saying that, okay, we cannot just hang out and do homework and get them to watch movies. Let's start doing projects. So that project could be a magazine. I got them to do a newsletter where I use my photography skills to get them to take pictures of their neighborhood.
Wow.
And the kids are good at graphics.
Yeah.
So we would create like a two-pager, about one sheet. We put the pictures. Every week they do something in the neighborhood, from basketball games or theater or something. And then this group that we call the photo club will do pictures and they will print them. And so we did that. By doing that work, I get connected to that community, most of whom are immigrants and other economically disadvantaged groups.
Okay.
So I started building a community around me through the young people that I work from one neighborhood to the other in the city that I live. In 2013, and in between this, I've worked with other, I've started youth groups that I have run for a couple of years. I have worked with other organizations. I've worked with people who are homeless. I've worked with young people who are incarcerated. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about young people between the age of 12 and 18.
Okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you were telling us about your background with education, you ended at West Africa Senior
Secondary School.
Yes.
Yeah.
Did you further your education at any point again?
Not the traditional. I attempted, by work or not, I have taken a couple of classes. But what I did was that anytime I have a job, I look for, courses that will improve my skills in the job that I'm doing.
Okay.
Whether it is leadership programs or short courses at you have a lot of that in the U.S.
Wow.
And so, or trainings that will come to me through my work where they will say that, because every industry have a skills building trainings. Mm. So you will have emails saying that, oh, there's this 2 weeks or this weekend.
Okay.
And I took a lot of those. And then in 2013, I helped in 2011, 2012, I helped created a program which I still work on as my daytime job. Whilst doing that job, it's a program that help immigrants understand the way the education system work in America.
Okay.
And then get their kids to also understand the type of classes that they're taking and how can they change things that are not working for them. whilst working there, one of my colleagues, if you've ever heard of a reluctant public servant or reluctant leader, one of my colleagues called me and said, hey, there is a 2 seats on the school board or board of education. In the U.S., each city have control over what goes on in their school system and what is taught and the budget. It all comes from the school board. Mm-hmm. Are the one, they are the governing body that governs the education system
in
their town or city. So this woman and her friend, she is my colleague at the office. They call me one evening and say, yeah, listen, we're having a dinner party here and we saw that there are 2 openings on the school board. And we hope that you will consider running for one of them because of the work that you are doing. And I said to her, I said, you mean run for office? She said, yes. And I said, I'm not interested. and she said, why? And I said, I don't like politics. And she said, since I know you, everything that you've done is politics.
Yeah.
And I said, no. I don't like organized elected politics. This woman, she didn't leave me alone. Mm-hmm. She called me the second day, and I think it was a Friday, Saturday. On Monday, when I went to the office, I said to my supervisor that, remember the lady that we work with here? She said, and the supervisor looked at me and said, so, you sure? I think you are the best person to do this because of what you do for work. Long story short, I called a couple of close friends, and I said, and everybody's like, come on, do it. And so I did it. I got elected. It was 2 seats. Two of us got elected out of 6 people. And then I work on the school board for 3 years, which is one thing, from 2013 to 2016. And then in 2016, there was an opening on the city council, which is the governing body for the city. It's like, just like the way you have a president and the cabinet, you have the mayor and city councilors. And they are the ones that make up, we are the ones that make laws for the city. We are the ones that make sure that everybody who lives in our city is safe. We are the ones that make sure that the police, the fire department, the public health, the roads, and everything is properly done. So there was an open seat, and I ran. And then got elected. I ran against 2 other people. And in both cases, I think, according to the media back there, I made history. I became the first African immigrant.
If that is what I was going to ask you,
first Muslim
to be elected
to be elected
office in my state.
Yeah.
No, you are such an incredible soul.
So, you know what I've noticed? Every time he's moved into the next level, it's something from what he has been doing.
Yeah, he's a
that has taken
person.
Him to the next one, right? So the photography he was doing in Ghana, it's like, okay, I'm leaving Ghana, I'm going somewhere else. But he started walking around a photo shop.
Yeah.
Then he connects his photography to education. But education not in the formal sense, it's just youth groups,
exactly.
little kids,
yeah.
help them out, but let's use the photography to do this. Then we connect that. Then from the teaching the little kids, let's do something more organized and formal. He gets into education proper. He gets elected into onto a board mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. school board. Mm-hmm. And then from there, he's...
No, so what I pick from this conversation is giving back, mm. right? Because when he was in Ghana, mm. when he was taking photos, you know, yeah. he would take photos that he probably thought, well, I'm pretty passionate about this, so I'm yeah. just taking pictures.
Yeah.
But this was how you were also helping put Ghana somewhere,
yeah.
you know. People see, and because we say that a photo is worth 1,000 words.
Yes.
So the things that
Absolutely.
You felt you couldn't say, mm. your photographs were doing that. And then you took it a notch higher by working with newspapers, with magazines, still giving back. Now, what I also realized is when you traveled, that is why I asked you about your education, because under normal circumstance, you would have people who have been formally trained, mm. you know, for things like that. But wanting to be part of the society, be mm. part of people's lives, you know,
yeah.
and help people grow.
Yeah.
I mean, it was basic.
Yeah.
And because you would think that, well, it's a little I can do. I'm just trying to do this, not a big deal, you know. But all this while, what has been your mentality, you know, up until the time that you could take maybe decisions for yourself, up until the time that you could have dreams? What did you want to become at WAS? What were you hoping to be one day? I mean, what did you want to find yourself?
So, like I said, you said something that is very important, building people. So I find myself in a community that have a lot of people who are either immigrants or economically challenged background, or who I have shared identity with, mm. Shared similar journey in life, lived life experience. Mm. And the parents do not necessarily understand the way the system works. And I am very lucky because some of them are coming from non-English speaking countries.
Mm. Mm.
And I'm lucky to be coming from a place like Ghana
yeah.
with a lot of values that I brought with me. And also, I was raised by my community,
mm.
And shout out to my people in Nima and Sawom and Zongolane where I grew
okay.
up. I was raised by the village,
mm-hmm.
and that is what I took with me.
Mm.
And that mentality of the kid that lives next door is not just the child of your next door neighbor.
Of the parents,
right?
Yeah.
He or she is also yours.
Mm.
It's what shape, how do we call it, the work that I did and mm. that I am doing. And even before I got elected, my dream then was to continue working. And when you see a young person mm-hmm. that you know next door, or that you know three buildings away, or that you mm. know in the community, and you know that there's no opportunity for that young person, and you help that person grow,
mm-hmm.
and then you watch them become someone in the community
yeah.
that they live in, they become the bus drivers, they become the teachers,
yeah.
they become the medical doctors,
mm.
they become the... whatever it is that the city that you live in, you see a reflection
yeah.
of yourself in those individuals,
mm.
in those young people. So things like that was my dream.
Mm.
I see my political office as an elevation.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the next higher mm-hmm. because it is the same thing that I am doing by mm. putting in policies
yeah.
that will create opportunities
mm.
for those people that mm. I care about, that I see myself in.
Mm.
So that was what I was hoping to do. And,
great.
I wasn't hoping that I wasn't thinking of political office, but I kept thinking I can elevate this program by
mm.
yeah.
the political office just happened to be.
You know, oftentimes I share your sentiments when they asked you, listen, we want you to run for this office. I'm not interested in politics. Because I've often said the same thing. I'm not interested in politics, right? But then the lady's response was, ever since I knew you, everything you've done has been politics. And I think that it's a very interesting, you know, way of looking at it, that you deal with politics is people and people are politics,
mm-hmm.
you know, and as long as you're dealing with people and helping to improve people's lives, impacting people's lives, that's what it is. Now, I'm looking at Ghana right now, and I'm looking at the idea you shared about it takes a village to raise one person. We find ourselves today where it's almost like we're becoming this society who doesn't want to intrude on other people's business, right? So instead of correcting their child, we look on we know what we want to say, but we are afraid to say it is because somebody will come and say that I'm overstepping my boundaries. What is your perspective, looking at where we were, what you've gone to experience, and coming back into Ghana, looking at the space that we have here? I mean, I know you're here for just a few more days, but what have you seen? What have you noticed? And what can we do as a people in our little communities?
I think the future of every society, the future of every community is based on how you treat your young ones, the type of opportunities that you create for them. The future of humanity in general is based on what do the people who are, whether it is leadership, and leadership does not necessarily mean elected office. It could mean in your neighborhood, you are the one with the skills. You are the one with the resources. And resources does not necessarily mean money, right? You see a group of kids who need help to do A, B, C, and you know in your network of friends and professional colleagues, you know Mr. X, Ms. Z, do have those skills. You pick up your phone, you call them, and you say, hey, I have this group of young people. Do you mind mentoring them? Or do you mind coming? We can put together an event for you to come and talk to these young people. I think, I don't know if we're doing that here. I think those are some of the, it's not the only, but those are some of the tools that we can all use. Because it doesn't matter how better you are doing. It doesn't matter how higher you go. If the people around you are not going with you, then it's meaningless. You have to connect your success to your community, to your neighborhood, to the city that you live in, to make sure that the future of that city or the future of that community is given into hands that are prepared and hands that have the ability and the skills to move it forward.
Do you often come to Ghana?
I didn't want to answer this question. I know it's coming. I left Ghana 21 years ago. This is my first time of coming home.
You are kidding me.
Yes.
Did we offend you?
Not really. I think I believe in the right time for everything. I think this is just the right time for me to come home, and I'm here.
So are you going to be coming more often now?
Inshallah. I'm a Muslim,
I would just say
that.
So how long have you been around?
Since October. Let's say it's been 10 days. I arrived last week, Tuesday, and I'm here, and I'm taking everything in.
Have you visited Nema?
Oh, yeah. I was in Nema a couple of times. I've been to Zongo Lane. I haven't been to some. I've walked around Adabaka. Actually, I walk by seeing some people that I know and not say anything.
They couldn't make you out.
Yeah, some people do make me out. Some people don't. And but eventually, I will go and talk to people.
But
that
what
I
memories,
know.
You know, what memories do your walking around bring to you?
I was talking to someone yesterday, and I said that I'm like an old computer operating system that have these memories in, which is all obsolete. And now what I'm doing is I am cleaning that. I'm reestablishing new memories.
You need to.
I went to the legal aid with a friend to just go see what they were doing. And on our way back home, this friend wanted to bring me back to where I live. I'm staying with a friend at Obujo. And I said, no. That was 2 days after I arrived. Okay. I said, no. And the friend was like, you're going to get lost. And I said, no, I'm not going to get lost. I walked from the law school to Zongo Lane, right? And this is a street that I have walked several times, hundreds of steps on that street from Makola, the former Rollins Park, back to Zongo Lane. And I thought I was going to get lost because everything changed. But thank goodness.
Somehow you found your way.
The roads have not been moved, right? They've not been shifted.
So
my legs knew where they were going, except that they look a little bit different. More people, more buildings.
Okay.
But the path, they are still there. So I took them back to, and then I just walk into a place and like, say hi. And I had my mask on, I have a cap. And and the one I took, they said, oh my goodness, Pius. So and I've had a lot of those.
Great.
Slowly replacing that memory.
You need to be coming home more often, because whatever you are doing for
Portland, Maine.
Portland, you know, we also need, I mean, we need you more.
So you know what? I think we need to, we've talked about it, but we need to show people
the
day he was sworn in. Let's take a look.
Council swearing in its two newest members. Councillors Pius Ali and Brian Batson were sworn in at a ceremony in council chambers this afternoon. The two defeated sitting members of the council in last month's election. They say they're ready to roll up their sleeves and get to work.
It's a reflection of the values of the city. And the other side of it is that I think it serves as motivation or inspiration to the young immigrants, whether they are Muslims or not, and minorities to the young people who live here, that they belong here.
And the city council did not waste any time immediately getting to work for the council session following the swing.
You know, it's such an inspiration when you see a Ghanaian, you know, rise to higher offices. We are so proud of you, you know, and telling a story. So sometimes when you hear people's profile, you feel you need to do so much, you know, because if you don't attend this school, if you don't do that course, if you don't get this degree, you can't do it. But when we sit with you and hear your story, we are inspired, because then you realize that no matter who you are, wherever you are coming from, you can be very impactful in society. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're such a cool cat. You know, it's like nothing's happening. No big deal, you know.
I'm grateful.
No, so, it's amazing. Thank you very much for sharing this with us.
Now, quickly before you leave us, you know, now you have, you've come back home. You're doing awesome stuff elsewhere. You know, just about the 10 days that you've been around, what have you seen, you know, walking on the streets, driving on the streets, going into communities and all that? What have you seen? What have you observed? What do you think Ghanaians should do? Just a word of advice for leaders and citizens alike.
Well, what I would say is that Ghana is a place that gives all of us values. That Ghanaian value is very high. You can compare it to any values in the world. And so wherever we find ourselves, whether it is here at home or abroad, use them. Make sure that whether you just move into your community or you live there all your life, make sure that whatever it is, that you make that place better than you found it. Make sure that you use whatever you have. Whether if all you know how to do is sweep, keep sweeping that neighborhood and make it look good.
Great.
Fantastic.
If all you know how to do is put water in a can and give it to people who need water, do that. That is what makes our world a better place.
Wow.
Fantastic.
That's wisdom.
It's beautiful.
Thank you.
Great. Counselor, thank you very much for joining
thank
us.
Thank you for having
We've
me.
Been privileged. So just in case you missed who he is, this is Pius Ali. He is the first African immigrant and Muslim elected to the City Council in Portland, Maine in 2016, and that is United States of America. He's also a youth and community engagement specialist for the University of Southern Maine and was previously a Portland School Board member. He's such a big man.
Well, you know what? Let's take a short break.
Yeah.
And Breakfast Daily will continue after that.